right, we're going to go ahead and get started this evening as we continue in our study through Hosea. We're going to open with a word of prayer and dive right into the text this evening. Avrahamim, Father of mercies, we worship you, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity for us to gather together as Mishpacha, as family before you. Lord, I pray that as we open up the Bible this evening, as we start digging further into Hosea, that you will speak into our hearts and our lives, that you will reveal to us an even greater depth of understanding about your character and nature, your desire for relationship with us, and your heart for all of humanity, and especially for all of Israel, to make teshuvah, to return back to you in faithful righteousness. Lord, I thank you for the blood atonement of Messiah that allows for us to make our way back to you, that opens up the door for us to come back into your loving embrace and to have our sins cleansed completely. B'shem Yeshua Meshachinu, in the name of Yeshua our Messiah, we pray, and everyone says, Amen. All right, so this evening we are picking up with Hosea chapter 11, because it's a shorter chapter, we might actually get through more than one chapter this evening. We'll see how that plays out. But we're going to read through the whole chapter in context, and then we'll come back and work through it piece by piece, as we typically do. Verse 1, when Israel was a youth, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. They called out to them, but they departed from their presence. They kept sacrificing to the Baalim and burning incense up to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them on my arms, but they never acknowledged that I had healed them. With human cords, I was drawing them with bonds of love, and I became to them as one lifting a yoke from their jaws. I bent down to them and fed them. He will not return to the land of Egypt, but the Assyrian will be his king, because they refuse to return. So a sword will fall on his cities and destroy and devour his gate bars because of their own counsels. So my people are bent on turning from me. Although they are being called upwards, none will rise up. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I surrender you, Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I set you as Zeboim? My heart is turning over within me. My compassions are kindled. I will not vent my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God, not a man, the Holy One in the midst of you, and I will not come in fury. They will walk after Adonai. He will roar like a lion. Indeed, he will roar. And the children will come trembling from the west. They will come trembling like bird out of Egypt, like dove out of the land of Assyria. And I will settle them in their houses. It is a declaration of Adonai. So real quick before we move on, just to clarify something for you, if you're reading with us this evening, watching online, if you're reading through the text with us in a traditional English Bible, perhaps something like the NIV, KJV, NASB, something like that, you're going to realize that I stopped a verse short of the end of chapter 11 in your translation, and that is because I'm using the Tree of Life version, the TLV, which is a Messianic Jewish translation, and the TLV uses a restoration of the original and proper Jewish ordering, verse and chapter ordering of the Tanakh, or the Old Testament. And so what is chapter 11, verse 12 in most English translations is actually 12:1 in the proper ordering, the proper Jewish ordering of the Tanakh. So don't be confused. Don't be lost. We'll come around to it. Just know when we get into chapter 12, where we'll be a verse or so off from where you are there. And the same thing happens again through later on in Hosea as well. So we're going to go back to verse 1. We're going to kick this off or dive right into it. And then we're going to move forward. When Israel was a youth, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. They called out to them, but they departed from their presence. They kept sacrificing to the Baalim and burning incense up to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them on my arms, but they never ever acknowledged what I that I healed them with human cords. I was drawing them with bonds of love, and I became to them as one lifting a yoke from their jaws. I bent down to them and fed them. He will not return to the land of Egypt, but the Assyrian will be his king, because they refuse to return. So a sword will fall on his cities and destroy and devour his gate bars because of their own counsels. So my people are bent on turning from me. Although they are being called upwards, none will rise up. So verse 1 is kind of interesting because it does a couple of things to us that I think are really kind of complex in the prophecy of Hosea as a whole. So first and foremost, if you remember back in Numbers, we have the Parsha Balak, in which Balak hires Bilam to go and try and curse Israel. Bilam tells him, I can only say what God allows me to say. He tries to get him to curse Israel 3 times anyways, and each of those 3 times, Bilam, instead of cursing, speaks promise and blessing over Israel. Well, if we go to Numbers chapter 23, verse 22, it says, God is bringing them from Egypt with strong horns and a wild ox. There is no sorcery left against Jacob, nor any divination against Israel. Now it will be said of Jacob and of Israel, see what God has done. The people rise like a lioness, like a lion who does not rest until he eats his prey and drinks his victim's blood. And then again in Numbers 24, verse 5, 24 verse 5, it says, as soon as I get my iPad to work the way I want it to. When you have fat fingers trying to work precise on an iPad, it just doesn't always work out. Verse 5 of Numbers 24, how lovely are your tents, O Jacob, your dwellings, O Israel, like valleys they are spread out, like gardens beside a river, like aloes planted by Adonai, like cedars beside the waters. Water will flow from his buckets, his seed by abundant water. His king will be greater than Agag. His kingdom will be exalted. God is bringing him out of Egypt like the strong horns of a wild ox. He devours nations hostile to him. He will crush their bones. His arrows will pierce them. He crouches like a lion or a lioness. Who will rouse him? He who blesses you will be blessed, and he who curses you will be cursed. So what we see that is really interesting is that the language of these second and third, ultimately blessings over Israel from Bilam rather than curses over Israel, that Hosea uses really similar language in the connective tissue there here in Hosea 11:1, which is important because Numbers 23:24, when we're looking at Bilam's blessings over Israel, are also prophetic, and they speak of the coming of Mashiach, the coming of Messiah, who we know to be Yeshua. So where this gets really even more interesting is that we see similar language used in another place in the Bible, particularly in Matthew chapter 2, verse 14. Matthew chapter 2, verse 14 through 15, in which is dealing with Yeshua as a young child. It says, so he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and went to Egypt. He stayed there until Herod's death. This was to fulfill what was spoken by Adonai through the prophet, saying, out of Egypt I called my son. Talking, kind of connecting back here to Hosea 11:1 and a few other places. And so we see that there's like this pattern, this prophetic pattern that's used from Bilam's prophecy or his blessings over Israel that's prophetic towards the Mashiach, to Hosea talking about Israel coming out of Egypt and being the beloved son of God that he brought out, to Yeshua and this connection to Yeshua being brought out of Egypt. Remember, they were trying to kill all the babies around Yeshua's infancy and such, and his family ran to Egypt to try and get away and protect him, and he's brought back from Egypt to the promised land, back from Egypt to Israel. So it's really neat to see these connective tissue pieces being brought together through the text. It goes on, they called out to them, but they departed from their presence. They kept sacrificing to the Baalim and burning incense up to idols. It says they called out to them, but they departed from their presence. The they that's being referenced by Hosea is the prophets of Israel, one of which is Hosea. But the they is the prophets of Israel, that the prophets of Israel continue to call Israel back in faithfulness to the Lord, calling them away from the Baalim, away from their unrighteous walks, away from their contradictory lifestyle from the ways of God. And they continued to ignore the prophets. They continued to refuse to do so. They kept sacrificing to the Baalim and burning incense up to idols. So they continued in idolatry. Yet, verse 3, it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them on my arms, but they never acknowledged that I had healed them. And so he's saying, look, you guys are walking away from me, walking contrary to me, but I need you to remember, I was the one that brought you out of Egypt as a young, as youth, right, as a child, because Israel was birthed, and there's this whole, and one day maybe I'll talk on this in when we get it back into Exodus in our Parsha cycle, but it's really interesting if you pay attention to Israel coming out of Egypt and the 10 plagues and Israel crossing through the Yam Suf and everything, there's a very interesting correlation between Israel's exodus and the actual legitimate physical birthing of a child through the birthing canal. The degree of the expansion of the cervix and everything, the coming through the Yam Suf and the water breaking, and I know really awkward and weird to hear and talk about, but there's this very interesting thematic connection between Israel coming out of Egypt and being birthed as a nation and the actual process of birthing a child. And so when we look at this and the Lord's talking about, look, I took you as a youth, as a young one, I birthed you out of Egypt and created you into a nation. I raised you up for myself. And now not only have you rejected my covenant, but you've rejected my prophets over and over and over again. Remember, I was the one that raised you up, taught you how to walk, carried you in my arms out of Egypt. I was the one that healed you from your wounds and your pains and your turmoil that you were in with human cords. I was drawing them with bonds of love, and I became to them as one lifting a yoke from their jaws. It was through love that I brought you to me, and I literally pulled the yoke of slavery out of your mouth. He will not return to the land of Egypt, but the Assyrian will be his king because they refused to return. So a sword will fall on his cities and destroy and devour his gates, his gate bars, because of their own counsels. So the Lord's saying, I'm not going to send you back to Egypt. You don't have to worry about Egypt, but you are going to be in captivity under the Assyrians. The Assyrian king will be your king, and the sword will crash against your cities. In other words, I'm going to let the armies that come at you to destroy your cities, I'm going to let them take the cities down and to carry you off into captivity. So my people are bent on turning from me. Although they are being called upward, none will rise up. The Hebrew word translated here in the TLV is bent, and often in many translations translated as bent, is a word that very literally means, it's the word tala, and it very literally means they're hung up on, right? Like, if you're walking and your shirt gets caught on a snag on a piece of wood or something like that, and you kind of get hung up and you're trying to get loose from it, the Lord says, my people are bent on, or they're hung up on, turning away from me. All they want to do, all they're focused on, is sinning and walking away from me. Although they are being called upwards, they're being called to righteousness, none will rise up. They continue to want to wallow in the filth of the world around them instead of standing upright in righteousness with me. So before we go forward, because this next section is really important, I just want to take a moment, if there are any questions or comments on the first seven verses or so of Hosea. If there are any questions or comments, please let me know so that we can take a quick moment to interact on those. Go ahead.
You got me. I thought it was interesting on the first verse. I'll make it quick, but it's kind of a complex issue, and you may not. I just think it's interesting. In the first verse, he says he called his son out. So obviously, like, he's the father. Israel's his son. I know he makes that reference with Pharaoh when he says, Israel's my firstborn. So I think it's interesting, though. But isn't in Hosea, there's also this husband-wife correlation. I guess I'm thinking of someone who, if they're really studying this, or they're really still learning about how God, the many facets of God's relationship with his people, how are we able to reasonably explain, like, okay, God is explaining a husband and wife relationship, now it's a father-son relationship?
Yeah. Well, first and foremost is that obviously God's not from Alabama. So that's not what we're dealing with here. But no, see, that's funny because we're a synagogue in Alabama, and I was it's going to be always a difficult thing, because when we're dealing with whether it's the husband-wife narrative or the father-child narrative, it's analogous, right? It's not necessarily exactly what it is, although there is a context or what have you, that complexity to that context is there. And so there is this concept of us being his children, because we're created in his image and likeness, but there's also the concept of us being the bride of the Lord, and we know that expansion of that conversation as the nations are brought into the Commonwealth of Israel through Messiah as the bride of Messiah. And so it can come across as really weird, but the key is to remember that it's metaphoric, right? It's not intended to be a literal interpretation or a literal understanding, but that it's metaphoric, and it's God showing us these, both the husband and wife and the father and child, and we can go and look at this in Ephesians, we can look at it in Galatians and Timothy and a number of other places, that when we look at the discussions of husband, wife, father, children, it's always about the concept of proper covering, proper authority, and it's always about the concept of covenant relationship, because there's a very specific and intentional covenant relationship between a bride and a groom, and biblically speaking, the groom is the head, the spiritual head of the household, and the same is true between a father and a child, is there's a covenant relationship there as well, and again, the father is the spiritual head, and we look at Ephesians particularly, where we see Paul talk about, wives submit to your husbands, husbands love your wives as Messiah loved the body, children be obedient to your parents, and slaves be obedient to your masters, etc. He's Paul's very clearly saying that there is a specific core or a specific structure, leadership structure, or spiritual head structure that's necessary for proper unity, right? And when we step outside of that, we break down that important unity that's necessary. And so what we're looking at here in Hosea, he starts out with the discussion of bride and groom, and then he kind of transitions using some of the language of father-child, because there's that context there as well. But both are simply metaphoric. Both are not intended to be literally taken that way, but rather to give us a greater understanding of who God is to us as that relationship, that idea of covenant relationship, and proper authority in that relationship for unity with. Anything else? All right, verse 8. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I surrender you, Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I set you as Zeboim? My heart is turning over within me. My compassions are kindled. I will not vent my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God, not a man, the Holy One in the midst of you, and I will not come in fury. So right out the gate, he says, how can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I surrender you, Israel? And then he talks about this location called Admah and another one called Zeboim. And those are actually neighboring cities to Sodom and Gomorrah. Admah and Zeboim were two of the cities that were destroyed when Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed. And they're used here as a kind of a symbol of the depravity of Israel, of the idea of sheer and utter destruction that comes because of the sins of Israel, just as happened with Sodom and Gomorrah and these two cities as well. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I surrender you, Israel? Verse 8, the beginning of verse 8, is directly connected to the concept of the wayward child that we find in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verses 18 through 21. And this wayward child, if you read the passage, it says, as a matter of fact, here, we'll open it real quick and we'll look at it together. It's only a couple of verses. chapter 21, Deuteronomy 21, verse 18 through 21. Suppose a man has a stubborn or rebellious son who does not listen to the voice of his father or mother. They discipline him, but he does not listen to them. Then his father and mother are to grab a hold of him and bring him out to the elders of the city, to the gate of the place. They will say to the elders of the city, "This son of ours is stubborn and rebellious. He does not listen to our voice. He is a glutton and a drunkard." Then all the men of the city are to stone him with stones to death. So you will purge the evil from your midst, and all Israel will hear and be afraid. So there's a couple of things here. First and foremost, this is not like a 4 or 5 year old or an 8 year old. This isn't an 18 year old. This is a grown adult man responsible for himself who has become a drunkard and a glutton. Anybody ever met a 3 year old that was drunk constantly? That was just a sheer alcoholic, like a 3 years old, right? We like to look at this narrative, and we like to, because it makes it seem, because most believers really have no connection to the Tanakh or to the Old Testament, right? Especially to the Torah. There's no intimate connection to the Tanakh, especially to the Torah. And so a lot of times people look at this and they're like, oh, look at how mean the God of the Old Testament was, right? The God of the Old Testament is vindictive and angry, whereas the God of the New Testament is a God of love and compassion and mercy and grace and so on. But the reality is in this narrative, and Toby asked me about this as he was preparing for a message for a couple of weeks from now. So I'm going to throw a little bit out there that he'll probably also mention in his message soon. But what's really interesting about the wayward child is that it's not a small child, it's a grown adult. And so the parents have to be willing to say flat out, there's no hope left for my child, right? I have no hope left that my kid will ever turn around and walk right with God. That's the whole point to it. The kid refuses to listen to the parents and refuses to walk in righteousness. I have no hope left for my kid, right? And the parent takes the kid to the gates, to the elders, and says, there's no hope left for my kid. We got to kill my kid. But if you read in this week's Parsha, Parsha Shoftim, it says multiple times that you can't kill somebody. Capital punishment in Israel can't be performed off of any less than 2 witnesses. There must be 2 or more witnesses. And Parsha Shoftim says that those 2 or more witnesses have to be the first ones to cast the stone. So the parents are those 2 or more witnesses. And the parents have to be willing to participate in the stoning to death of their own child. And what parent, 1, is going to say, there's no hope left for my kid, and 2, is going to say, now I'm going to participate in killing my kid because of the fact that they refuse to listen, right? It's just no parent's going to do that. As a matter of fact, Jewish history and tradition tells us that there's nowhere in the history of Israel that this ever actually occurred, that we ever actually saw the wayward child situation play out. But rather, what we do see over and over again, just as we see here in Hosea, is the imagery, the symbolism and the imagery of the wayward child play out in prophecy as God is calling Israel back to himself. And he says, I'm not done with you. I'm not giving up hope on you. Even though I've got to punish you, even though I've got to do this stuff to you and take you out of the promised land, even though I'm going to hand you over to captivity to the Assyrians or with Judah, I'm going to take you into captivity to the Babylonians or hand you off under control of the Romans and so on. Even though all of these things are going to happen, I want you to know I'm not done with you, right? You go back to Abraham. The covenant made with Abraham was that it was an eternal covenant with Abraham and his descendants from then on, and God would never leave us. No matter how much we leave him, how far away we walk, no matter how far we try to run or how hard we try to run, God will never leave us. God will never say there's no hope left for you. How do we know that? Because God himself came robed in flesh and sacrificed his own life, offered his own life for our sins. Why? Because God didn't want to say there's no hope left for us. Not only was there still hope for us, but God became the hope for us. He didn't say there's no hope left for you. He said, I'm now your hope. Should have been on your hope all along, but here's where you trust in me. Here's that connection now. Here's where you can come into me in righteousness. And so he says, how can I give up on you, Ephraim? How can I surrender you, Israel? How can I make you like Admah, how can I set you as Zeboim, completely demolished and destroyed? My heart is turning over within me. My compassions are kindled. He says, my heart is wrecked. How many of us as parents have told our kids it's going to hurt me more than it hurts you? Right, I used to really hate when my parents would say that to me. It was always my dad, not my mom. Not that my mom like didn't feel sorry when she had to punish me, but it was usually wait till your dad gets home, because my mom knew his spank would get my attention more than hers. And so And when my dad would say, this is going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you, I'm like, you're lying through your teeth. You're not the one getting spanked. It's me. Like, there's no way this is going to hurt you more than it hurts me. And then I had kids, and I had to punish my kid for the first time and break their heart. I had to watch my kid cry because of whatever punishment took something away from them, had to spank them, put them in timeout, whatever it is. Because, and when you watch your child and you have to punish them in whatever way, their crying and their sorrow, their pain is generally not because of the punishment, but because they realized that what they did was something that hurt you or broke your heart or made you upset or was an act of faithlessness to you. It was something that was against you. And so that's what breaks their heart. And so when I had to watch my kid cry for the first time because I had to punish them, like, suddenly I realized what that statement means. And I still refuse to use it because it just doesn't sound right in my head. And I always hated hearing it. But nonetheless, I recognize the weight and the value of it. And when I think about Abraham being called to take Isaac up the mountain to offer him as a sacrifice before the Lord, and Abraham's walking up the mountain with Isaac, and Isaac's carrying the wood for the offering on his back, and they've got the fire, and Abraham's got the knife, and Isaac turns to Abraham and goes, hey, Pop, we got the wood, we got the fire, but where is the sacrifice? Where's the offering? And Abraham says, don't worry. God will provide himself a ram. I can picture that conversation where Abraham's going, look, first off, I want you to understand, Isaac was well aware what was going on. I don't believe that this was a test of Abraham's faith, as we often like to say it in the Sunday school story. It wasn't a test of Abraham's faith. Abraham's faith had already been tested when God said, Lech lecha, get up and go. His faith had already been tested. This was a test of Isaac's faith. Notice when we look at the stories of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Abraham and Jacob, we see very clear defining moments biblically in their narrative where where their faith in God was tested, and they were shown approved in their faith. Isaac, we don't see that anywhere except in the Akedah, in the binding of Isaac. And I believe that as they're walking up, and Abraham and Isaac are walking up, and Isaac goes, Pop, I see the fire in the wood. Where's the sacrifice? I think Abraham's heart, he's thinking and he's saying, this is going to hurt me more than it hurts you. As Abraham's tying him down, right? Isaac was a grown man also. It wasn't a little boy either. He was anywhere from his 20s to his early 30s. He was fully grown. Abraham was 100 years older than him. Abraham wasn't tying him down on that altar if Isaac wasn't okay with it. My dad's only 20 years older than me, and there's no way I'm letting my dad tie me down unless he knocks me out first. It's just not going to happen, right? And that's the case. There's a 100-year difference there. I believe as Abraham is preparing to tie Isaac down, that Abraham's looking at Isaac going, this is going to hurt me more than it hurts you. Because while it's a test of your faith, I'm the one having to go through it with you. I'm the one having to participate. But they both believed in perfect faith, because before Isaac ever said, where's the offering at? Where's the sacrifice at? I see we got the wood and the fire. Where's the sacrifice? Before he ever said that, Abraham had already told his servants, hey, you guys stay here. Me and the boy are going up, and we will both come back down to you. Abraham knew in perfect faith that they were coming back down. He didn't know how. He didn't know if God was going to provide an alternative sacrifice, a substitutionary sacrifice, or God was going to resurrect Isaac from the dead or what, but he knew without a doubt that they were both coming back down from that mountain, because this was the child of promise, the seed of promise through whom the entire world would be blessed. He was well aware of this. And so in the same sense that Abraham's heart was torn and was in turmoil and was turning over within himself, and his compassion for Isaac was boiling, we see the same in the heart of God for his children, for his creation, for Israel. And again, as I said last week or 2 weeks ago, whatever it was, I wholeheartedly believe that this book of Hosea, although very much speaking to the northern kingdom, the kingdom of Israel, also has absolute real-world implications for us today for the body of Messiah. And so he carries on, I will not vent my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God, not a man, the Holy One in the midst of you, and I will not come in fury. In other words, I will not completely wipe you out, right? I'm not going to completely wipe you out, but I am going to take you off from here. And he says, why am I not going to completely wipe you out? Because I am holy and I am walking in your midst. Notice he says, I, the Holy One, in the midst of you, despite the fact that Israel, the northern kingdom, was so buried in their sin, The Lord's still in their midst. He's still there with them, right? So I want you to understand this, because it doesn't matter how far we try to run from God or how much we walk contrary to him or how terrible our lives look, the Lord is always standing right there with us. And he wants us to turn back to him. He's constantly pulling at the, tugging at our heartstrings, saying, just come back, just return. Make teshuvah, repent, come back to me. My arms are open. I want you to come back. I think of the prodigal son. We talked about it a couple of weeks ago. I think of the prodigal son. The father sat on his porch the entire time waiting for the prodigal son to come back. He was looking down the driveway. He was looking down the road waiting for him to come back. I picture him on, you know, a wraparound porch in the country somewhere, rolling in a rocking chair, just kicking back with his coffee, waiting for his long-lost son to come back, right? And all of a sudden he sees him from a distance, and what does the father do? He doesn't just sit there and wait for him to come groveling. That's every intention that the son had, but he doesn't wait for him to come groveling. The father runs and throws his arms around him and gives him a kiss and says, my son, I'm glad you're home, right? This is the heart of Adonai. This is the heart of God for his people, for Israel, and for all of his creation. This isn't just for Israel itself. This is the heart of God for all of his creation. Israel is an example that God called out. Israel is the smallest people of all the people on the face of the earth that God called out solely for the purpose of drawing the nations back into himself, of being a light to the nations and bringing the nations, all of creation, back in unification with the Father. So this is God's heart for Israel, for the northern kingdom, who's about to be dispossessed from the land, but it's also his heart for all of his creation. Verse 10, they will walk after Adonai. He will roar like a lion. Indeed, he will roar, and the children will come trembling from the west. They will come trembling like a bird out of Egypt, like a dove out of the land of Assyria, and I will settle them in their houses. It is a declaration of Adonai. So when we look at this, this idea of the wayward son, or not the wayward son, this idea of verses 10 and 11, he says, I'm going to take them from here. My fury is not going to be completely poured out on them. I'm going to kind of leave a remnant. I'm going to save some of them, but they are going to go off into Assyrian captivity. He says, but then they'll walk back after Adonai. They will turn back around. Right, you go through the blessings, the curses of Deuteronomy, and the Lord says, if you don't walk in faithfulness with me, then this is going to happen. If that doesn't get your attention, then this is going to happen. If that doesn't, he goes through a series of five of these. And then he says, and when the time comes that all of these, both the blessings and curses, have befallen you, then you will cry out and turn your heart back to me and come back in full relationship with me. And this is what the Lord is saying here. All of this is happening solely for the purpose of bringing you in restoration, bringing Israel in restoration. And so this verse 10 and 11, whether you, I don't know if you realize this or not, but it's actually a messianic prophecy. It has messianic prophetic implications. As Israel does not fully and permanently ever return from Assyria, right? Some do, some come back, but Israel does not fully return from Assyria. But beyond that, it would appear as though this may be speaking of an eschatological restoration. Hosea describes a return from the west, from Egypt, the south, and from Assyria, the north. He speaks of a permanent settlement in the land, not of a temporary, not of them just coming back and being taken captive by Romans, but it speaks of a permanent settlement in the land, a resettlement in the land, and the description of the nation returning in humility in their walk before the Lord shows a spiritual transformation that Israel did not see at the return of captivity from either Assyrian or Babylonian captivity, but points to the restoration of Israel through faith in Messiah in the days to come when, as Paul puts it, all Israel will be saved, right? They'll come from the west, they'll come from the north, they'll come from the south. And what are we seeing today in Israel? As God is bringing Jewish people, making aliyah from every corner of the world, from the west, from here in the States, from the north, from the south, from even from the east and so on. We're seeing the nation, the Lord called the nation of Israel from the four corners of the world and back to Israel, back to the promised land. And I believe the day is coming, and I pray wholeheartedly that it be soon, that our Jewish people's eyes and hearts will finally, truly, completely be open to the truth of Messiah of Yeshua as the Messiah, the promised Messiah of Israel. So with that said, we've now closed out chapter 11. Any questions, comments on any of chapter 11? I am watching, I forgot to say this at the beginning, I am watching the Facebook Live comments. So if there are any comments or questions that you have and you're watching online, please feel free to post them there or on the CMC app. If you're watching through Boxcast, you can post on our app and I will interact with you there as well. So any questions, comments through chapter 11? If not, then we will roll into chapter 12. Look at us. We're making progress through two chapters, or at least part of two chapters, in one night. I'm not really sure how I let that happen. all right, chapter 12, verse 1. We're going to read the whole chapter in context, and then we'll come back piece by piece. Ephraim surrounded me with lies, and the house of Israel with deceit. Though Judah roams restlessly with God, yet he is faithful with holy things. Ephraim is grazing on wind and pursuing the east wind. All day he multiplies lies and ruin, making a pact with Assyria while carrying oil to Egypt. Adonai also has a dispute with Judah. He will punish Jacob for his ways, repaying him for his deeds. In the womb he grasped his brother's heel, and in his vigor he strove with God. Yes, he wrestled with the angel and won. He wept and sought his favor at Bethel. He will find us, and there he will speak with us. Even Adonai Elohei Tzevaot, Adonai is his memorial name. So you should return to your God. Keep covenant loyalty and justice, and wait for your God continually. And a merchant loves to extort with the deceptive balances in his hand. Now Ephraim has said, how rich I have become. I found wealth by myself. I won't be guilty of any sin with any of my property. Yet I have been Adonai your God since the land of Egypt. I will yet again make you dwell in tents as in the days of the Moed. I also spoke through the prophets, and I multiplied visions. Now through the prophets, I will make parables. Since Gilead is full of iniquity, they are utterly worthless. In Gilgal, they sacrifice bulls. Even their altars will become heaps of rocks along the furrows of my field. Now Jacob fled to the field of Aram. When Israel served for a wife, yes, he kept watch for a wife. So by a prophet, Adonai brought Israel up out of Egypt, and by a prophet he was kept. Ephraim has provoked bitter anger, so his blood guilt will remain on him. His Lord will repay him for his contempt. So back to verse 1. Ephraim surrounded me with lies, and the house of Israel with deceit. Though Jacob roams restlessly with God, yet he is faithful with holy things. So again, we see this kind of dichotomy or separation between the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. Again, Ephraim with the northern kingdom is often synonymous for Israel or the northern kingdom, and then Judah synonymous for the southern kingdom, the kingdom of Judah. So he says, Ephraim surrounded me with lies and the house of Israel with deceit. In other words, you walked away from me, you acted like you were serving me, you were doing things like you wanted to serve me, but you really were serving all these other gods and the Baalim and Ashtera and so on and so forth. Though Judah roams restlessly with God, yet he is faithful with the holy things. And the actual Hebrew is, I think, better translated as he is faithful with the Holy One, not the holy things. Although the holy things is referencing when a lot of translations will translate it to holy things because it's reference to the temple that stood in Judah, in Jerusalem, in the kingdom of Judah. And the temple is where the holy things, the altar, the table of showbread, the menorah, the Aron HaBrit, the Ark of the Covenant, and so on and so forth. All of the holy things were there in the temple. And so when it talks about it translates to the holy things, as I said, I think it's better translated as the Holy One, but holy things is adequate there as well in reference to the temple. But he says, though Judah roams restlessly with God, in other words, he kind of veers off the path of righteousness from time to time, he is still faithful with his holy things, or with the holy things, unlike Israel, unlike the northern kingdom, who's just completely walked away from God altogether. Ephraim is grazing on wind and pursuing the east wind. All day he multiplies lies and ruin, making a pact with Assyria while carrying oil to Egypt, making pacts with all these other nations, making political treaties and relationships. But the Torah specifically tells Israel, do not make political treaties with other nations. Why? Because God is your protector. God is your defender. God is your king. And as long as you walk in faithfulness with him, you won't need anybody else to protect you or to care for you or to guard you, because he is doing all of those things. Adonai also has a dispute with Judah. He will punish Jacob for his ways, repaying him for his deeds. In the womb, he grasped his brother's heel, and in his vigor, he strove with God. So we see all of a sudden the language shift a little bit, right? And he goes to Jacob, which Jacob is a reference to Israel. You know, Jacob's name was changed to Israel, so it's a reference to Israel, the nation, but not just the northern kingdom. It's a reference to both Judah and Israel, the southern kingdom, the northern kingdom together. The Lord says, look, I got issues with the north, but I've also got issues with the south. I've got issues with the north. I've also got issues with the south. But then he changes his language and he starts to talk about the journey of Israel, Jacob, Yaakov, the journey of Jacob from going through as a tricker, one who tricks and grabbed the heel of his brother on the way out and tricked his brother into his birthright and into his blessing and all of these kinds of things. And he tricks his father-in-law out of a whole bunch of sheep and different animals. So he goes through this whole path from being one who tricks and is kind of a terrible human being to one who's walking in righteousness and deemed a child of God. So he says, he will punish Jacob for his ways, repaying him for his deeds. In the womb, verse 4, in the womb he grasped his brother's heel, and in his vigor he strove with God. Yes, he wrestled with the angel and won. He wept and sought his favor. At Bethel he will find us, and there he will speak with us. Now he's saying this, telling us kind of the history of our forefather Jacob, but also telling us of the reality that we are supposed to be Israel, right? And what does Israel mean? When Jacob's name was changed to Israel, what does it mean? It means one who wrestles with God, right? And it doesn't mean he wrestles with God as in, like, you know, God's trying to give us a hug and we're pushing him away from us. No, it's one who wrestles with, between the world and God, right? We're trying to break away from the world and become more like the image and likeness that we were created in. And so we're constantly in this tension, right? We're fallen humanity. In the world that we live in today, we are fallen humanity, and we're in this constant tension between what the world is trying to drag us down to do, what the enemy is trying to tempt us to do, and what God desires for us to do and who God desires for us to be. And so Israel is one who wrestles with God in this tension, trying to break free of the world and become more like what God desires us to be. And so there's this constant. Also, the name Israel, or Yisrael in Hebrew, the name Israel is really important, because if you ever, and maybe you've not encountered this before, I don't know, but if you ever pay attention to the Jewish train of thought, especially as it comes to digging through Scripture and through commentary on Scripture, the Jewish train of thought is always one of question, right? So most other faiths are always trying to answer questions. In Judaism, we're just looking for the next question, right? And so there's always this joke that if you ask a rabbi a question, they're going to answer with a question, right? Or if you ask a Jewish person a question, they're answer with a question. And it's not really a funny matter. It's just how the Jewish heart works. Like, we're constantly wanting to know more. If you look through Mishnah and Gemara, you look through the Talmud, you look through the writings of the rabbis and the sages over the millennia, and what you notice is it's a rabbi poses a question, another rabbi responds, another rabbi responds to that, another rabbi poses another question, and all of that, and there's more response, and it's back and forth, and it's just this constant debate back and forth. And the thing about it is, that's the heart of Israel, is we're in tension, we're in this constant tension between the world around us and God pulling us toward him and us trying to become more like him. It's this constant tension. So Israel, one who wrestles with God, is a very intentional, very adamant, very important name altogether. Even Adonai Zevaot, Adonai is his memorial name. Now, this is a really important, and I'm going to take a quick second to talk about this. This is a really important reality for us, all right? Because in the the peripheral of Messianic Judaism. I deal with this in our members class every time it comes around as well. On the peripheral of Messianic Judaism, you have a lot of people that I like the nomenclature. I like to call them sacred namers. In Hebrew, you've got the name Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. It's a four-letter name of God, the sacred name. We call it the Tetragrammaton, which is from the Greek, meaning the four-letter name or the four-letter word. And so the Tetragrammaton, the sacred name, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, in Judaism, we don't pronounce this word. And so if you're using, like if you've got the Chiyomai version of the Bible, and you see Adonai as we see here in verse 6, we see it twice, A-D-O-N-A-I, all caps, but the D-O-N-A-I are all smaller caps, so you've got a large cap A and smaller cap D-O-N-A-I. If you see that, that means that in the Hebrew, the actual word is Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. And we don't pronounce that name, that word in Judaism today because Hebrew was a dead language conversationally for years and years and years and years and years, for centuries realistically. And so, and that name particularly, as far as we can tell historically, was only actually used verbally by the priests, by the Aaronic priesthood. The common Israel didn't use it haphazardly. It wasn't something we just threw around haphazardly. As a matter of fact, when God says, "Do not take my name in vain," that's what he's talking about. It's not a good thing to say GD either, but that's specifically what he's talking about is we've got to be careful how we portray his name, how we relate his name in our lives, and how we interact with that name. And so Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is the most sacred name of God, and as such, we don't know how to pronounce it, so we don't. And we use other qualifiers, other names, other descriptors used in Scripture for God, like Adonai, like Elohim, like Elohei, like God or Lord in English. Adoshem used to be really popular in Orthodox Judaism, which means the name of God, or Hashem, which literally just means the name. You hear me use Hashem and Adonai a lot. And so in Judaism today, we don't pronounce Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh because we don't know how it's pronounced. And every word in Hebrew has a very specific meaning. And if we mispronounce a word, we've changed its spelling. And by changing its spelling, we've now changed its meaning. So we're very careful, cautious, and protective of the sacred name of God out of reverence for who God is and his character and nature. And so here in Hosea 12, verse 6, he says, "Even Adonai Elohei Tzevaot, Adonai is his memorial name." This is a knock back to, or a nod back to, a reference back to Exodus chapter 3, verse 14 and 15, when Adonai is calling Moses on Mount Sinai to go and free Israel from Egypt and to be his spokesperson. And Moses says, "Well, God, who, if I do go do this, if I do what you ask, who do I tell them sent me?" And so verse 14 of Exodus 3 says, God answered Moses, "I am who I am. Ashe, ayer, ashe. I am who I am. I am who I am." Then he said, "You are to say to Bnei Israel, to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you." Right? So what's the name that Abraham is to give them? I am. Not Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, I am. God also said to Moses, "You are to say to Bnei Israel, Adonai, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has sent me to you." And the word there, "You are to say to Bnei Israel, Adonai," in the Hebrew is Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. He says, "This is my name." This is the most sacred and holy name. He says, "This is my name forever." Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is my name forever. "And the name by which I should be remembered from generation to generation," ledor dor, from generation to generation. Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is my name. It is a memorial name for me from generation to generation. He doesn't say it's the name you're to converse with me in. He doesn't say it's the name you're to talk to me in. He doesn't say it's a name that you throw out there like it's, you know, just any traditional, you know, whatever word, like it doesn't have any real value to it. It's not just a name you haphazardly throw around. It is to be a memorial for you, a remembrance for you. It is something that we are to protect, that we are to guard, that we are to care for. So in Judaism today, we don't pronounce this name because it is a memorial, and we protect it and we care for it and we're very careful. We know exactly who we're speaking about and so on. So we don't pronounce his name. And he says here, even Adonai Elohei Tzavot, Adonai is his memorial name. Again, reminding us who it is that's giving us this message through Hosea, who it is that's calling us back into himself, but he's still reminding us that his name, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the most sacred name, the Tetragrammaton, is not a word that is haphazardly used, but instead it is a word by which we remember him, or it is a memorial of him forever and ever. So you should return to your God, keep covenant loyalty and justice, and wait for your God continually. A merchant loves to extort with deceptive balances in his hand. So he says right out the gate here again, you've got all this promise of destruction, all of this, these warnings of captivity and by the Assyrians and the destruction of the walls of Israel, the cities of Israel, and so on and so forth. But again, verse 7, so you should return, you should make teshuvah, return to your God, and keep covenant loyalty with him continually. Keep covenant loyalty and justice with him forever. Keep chesed and zedek with him forever. And wait for your God continually. Now, this is important because not only is God saying, hey, I don't want to do all these terrible things to you. I don't want to make this stuff happen, all these negative things to happen to you. I want you to return back to me, to make teshuvah, to come back to me. But he says, even once it happens, I need you to remember the way that it ends is when you come back to me. So whether it's before or after, all you have to do is return. All you have to do is repent. All you have to do is turn back to the Lord, and he will forgive you, restore you, and renew you. He will make you whole again. And this is a powerful promise for Israel as we look through the journey of Israel and ultimately going into slavery, into captivity in Assyria. Verse 9, now Ephraim has said, how rich I have become. I found wealth by myself. I won't be guilty of any sin with any of my property. Pretty interesting, right? Because God says, once you step into the promised land, this is back in the Torah, once you step into the promised land and you have all of the blessings I've told you to, we're going to come to you, don't become arrogant and think you did this by yourself. Don't become arrogant and think you did this by yourself. Remember who it is that gave you these blessings. Remember who it is that cared for you, that brought you out of Egypt, that protected you through your journey. Remember who it was. Do not become arrogant and say, oh, I've done all this for myself. Look at all of this that I've built up. And God says, no, don't do that. Right, he warns us all the way back in the Torah that this attitude might come about. So we're supposed to protect ourselves from it. Verse 10, yet I have been Adonai your God since the land of Egypt. I will yet again make you dwell in tents as in the days of Moed. Anybody know what Moed we're talking about here? Sukkot. Right? What's the point to Sukkot? I talk about this almost every single year here at Maim Chaim as Sukkot rolls around and as we're going through Sukkot. One of the most important aspects of Sukkot is that we're commanded by God to dwell in Sukkot, in temporary dwelling places, for an entire week. Why? So that no matter how great our life is, how terrible our life is, no matter where in the world we are, we always have a reminder of who we're supposed to be. We always have a reminder of what God brought us through and of what our forefathers experienced in Egypt, right? Passover, Pesach, and Sukkot, Passover and the Feast of Tabernacles are both Moedim, or both appointed days in which God says, you are to do this in such a fashion that your children ask you, why do we do these strange things? Why do we live in this shanty for a week? Why do we eat at the table in the shanty? Why do we wave these palm fronds and everything? Why do we eat the matzah for a week? Why do we drink the wine four times in our Seder? Why do we do all this stuff? He's supposed to ask those questions so that we can tell our children, because of everything that God has done for our forefathers and everything he's done for us up to this very moment and everything he will continue to do for us. I also spoke through the prophets and I multiplied visions. Now through the prophets I will make parables. Since Gilead is full of iniquity, they are utterly worthless. In Gilgal they sacrifice bulls. Even their altars will become heaps of rocks along with the furrows of my fields. And when we look at this, Gilead is in on the west side of the Jordan, where the two and a half tribes were at, and or the where the 2.5 tribes decided they wanted to stay on the other side of the Jordan instead of coming into the promised land. Gilead's over there, and it's a reminder of the rejection there. But it also had financial implications because it was a trading site and so on. And then Gilgal is in the northern kingdom itself near Samaria. And Gilgal is an area where very literally, very actively, and very much by choice, Israel made sacrifices and worshipped false gods, worshipped idols, fell into idolatrous practice for its entire existence as a nation separate from Judah. And so he says, all of these things are there, but I'm going to destroy it all. I'm going to tear it all back down to the ground, and you'll never even remember that it was there. Verse 13, now Jacob fled to the field of Aram when Israel served for a wife. Yes, he kept watch for a wife. So by a prophet, Adonai brought Israel up out of Egypt, and by a prophet he was kept. Ephraim has provoked bitter anger, so his blood guilt will remain on him. His Lord will repay him for his contempt. So the Lord's saying, you have held me and my relationship, or what was supposed to be a relationship with you, in contempt. You have taken it for granted. You have ignored me and pushed me away, and now you're going to pay the consequence and the price for it. But again, and as we get into especially chapter 14, the cry of God's heart throughout the prophets speaking of destruction and despair, the cry of God's heart is always restoration, repentance, and renewal. Right? Doesn't matter what you're walking through. It doesn't matter what your life looks like. It doesn't matter how terrible your situation is financially, job-wise, family-wise, whatever. None of that matters. All that matters is if you simply return to God, he will restore you and renew you. If you simply walk in faithfulness with him, even when the times are tough, he will restore you and renew you, right? We look at Job. Job's a great example. Job never discounted God. Job never cursed God. Job did say, I kind of wish I died instead of my kids, or I wish I died when my kids died, but he never straight up cursed God or spoke any ill against God or anything like that, and Job was restored and renewed. Now, obviously, Job would have been very sorrowful the rest of his life because he lost his children and everything, but he was restored and had more wealth, more children, more everything than he had to begin with. And it's an example for us of walking faithfully in righteousness, even when, for lack of a better way of wording it, proverbially speaking, the crap hits the fan. We must remain in righteous relationship with the Lord. And when we find ourselves walking contrary to that, we must make teshuvah. We must return and be restored. Amen? Any questions, thoughts, comments on Hosea chapter 11 or 12? We somehow managed to get through both of them. Questions, thoughts, comments? I'm going to leave the live stream running because I definitely want to see if there are any questions or comments that come in on Facebook, Facebook Live, as we move through. So
I had one question.
Yeah.
Verse 11, when he mentions parables, mm-hmm. is that a messianic reference?
To a degree, but it's really just saying, it's really just the Lord saying, hey, you know, I sent these prophets to you to call you back, but you didn't listen to them, right? So now their message of return, their message of restoration, their message of repentance is going to be parabolic. And so, because you didn't listen, you didn't take it to heart, you didn't heed it, right? So when Yeshua talks in parables, those parables are for the purpose of getting our attention. But if we're not listening and paying attention, or we don't understand them, right? He says, we talked about it on the Saturday, he says, you know, you have ears, but you don't hear, you have eyes, but you don't see. So if we don't understand those parables, then they're not doing us any good. And it's the same thing with the prophets. If we're not listening and understanding and heeding the prophets, then they're not doing us any good. So they become parabolic. Yeah.
So kind of, sort of.
Yeah. Sort of, kind of, yes and no, all at the same time. Any other questions, comments? Yeah, Yeshua was brought to Egypt. That's what I was talking about. Yeah, when I read from Matthew, that's what I was saying, is we see the...
Have kind of
correct.
But
Yeah, it's directly connected to it because Hosea is giving a nod back to Balaam's blessings/prophecies in Numbers 23:24, and Matthew's gospel is giving a nod back to Hosea and Balaam's prophecies in Yeshua being that son brought out of Egypt for the purpose of what? To provide a means for Teshuvah, for restoration and renewal. Any other thoughts, comments, questions? Going once, going twice. We will see you guys later. Thanks for joining us.